All right, let's bring Alex Knight on. He's from Boca Raton, Florida, and that is down in South Florida. And I know a little bit about the area that he is from. I was stationed in the United States Navy down in Key West, Florida for 4 years. Alex, good to have you on. How many times have you made the trip down to Key West, Florida?
Key West, well, thanks for having me, by the way. Yeah. Key West, probably like eighth grade, only once, because it's 6 hours from where I live.
Okay.
It's a hike.
Yeah. Well, it's for those who don't know, there's 150 miles of islands south of Miami. For people that didn't think there was anything south of Miami, there's 150 miles of islands, multiple bridges. There's a 7 mile long bridge at one point. And the very last island, 90 miles from Cuba, is Key West. So you've been down there. You've been down there one time.
One time in eighth grade, my friends. We went fishing down there. It was a great time.
Boy, now talk about fishing living in Florida, man. That's fun. People charter boats. They can go out. Hey, we want to go for some game fish, maybe marlin, a sailfish, or if you just want to go out and catch some snapper. I mean, there's all kinds of fishing that goes on in Florida.
Yeah, fishing's been a big part of my family my whole life. My dad, when he was 18, he fished a giant tuna fish competition up in, I think it was Boston or Maine. He caught a 650-pounder and won 10 grand. I said that in my senior spotlight a couple weeks ago, and that was one thing growing up I always wanted to do. So I love fishing, and just all the charters you got down there in Key West, like, it's insane how many tourists come down there and just check it out, and they love it.
Well, where you come from, is it as big a tourist spot as maybe a Lauderdale or a Miami in Boca Raton? Is it as big a tourist spot? Because I know oftentimes the locals – get irritated with tourists, don't they?
Not really, though, because it brings – my dad always says he's in real estate and been in it for years. He says it brings money in, and that helps the economy and everything. So he's never been – has no problem people coming in, especially Boca and Fort Lauderdale, especially Miami. Miami's been blowing up huge because you got so many people coming in from, like, all different places, moving down there, especially from California, because it's so much cheaper to live in Florida than California, and you get the same thing.
So I guess I got to ask you, if everybody's going on spring break, do you just go home?
Yeah, pretty much. It's nice.
I mean, it's a spring break destination. What's spring break like living in Boca?
Spring break's pretty good, but Fort Lauderdale and Miami are definitely two hot spots. If you want to see some crazy things like in Panama City, you go down to Fort Lauderdale, Miami, and the beach is packed. You'll see people, kids going partying all day, having a great time.
The unique thing is, where you live in Florida, and I was living in Key West, is spring break goes on for over a month for the people that live there, because each week a new set of schools is having their spring break and they all kind of rotate down. So it can last up to like 4 or 5 weeks, right?
Yes, it can. And they love it. Especially my friend works on the beach. He like sells t-shirts and stuff. And he has his own company down there, and he loves spring break because he amps up the prices and makes so much money off those kids when they come down there.
But I'm a big I love seafood, and we would wait for the shrimp boats. They would go out in Key West. We would wait for the shrimp boats to come back. They would take the haul, clean them, and then you would buy them. And literally, you're walking home with a few pounds of shrimp that literally was alive about 90 minutes ago. I mean, that's how fresh you can get it.
Yeah, that's the best way to do it, especially fish in Florida. Like sushi, anywhere you go, you're going to get the high quality because you just catch from the sea and it's right there. And it's unbelievable. I love sushi. It's one of my favorite foods to eat.
Sushi. Now, you're not talking gas station sushi. You're talking about the real deal.
I'm talking about the real deal. Like sometimes my dad, we catch a nice little tuna. We'll cut it up, fillet it right there, spray some water on it, and eat it right after you catch it. It's that fresh. It's the best way to eat it.
Red Hawks All-American punter Alex Knight, our guest here on the Coach's Show. We're at Wings, Etc. in Cape. But what is the best fishing story you have? Maybe the biggest fish or the biggest fight that you've had with maybe a game fish? Give us a good fishing story.
All right. The best fishing story I got to say was probably like sixth grade, a long time ago. It was me, my dad, and my brother, and it was really rough out on Thanksgiving. We went out fishing, and we were fishing all day. We're getting beaten up. The boat's getting tossed back and forth. And all of a sudden, my brother hooked up on a 60-pound wahoo. And it was literally the best moment of my life because he's catching this big wahoo. I'm like, yes, we got dinner. It's going to be so good. And everything's going good. It's Thanksgiving. God's giving us a good fish. And it was one of the best Thanksgiving I probably ever had.
How big was it?
60 pounds. So it's like this long. It's pretty big.
Man, how long did you guys eat on that thing?
Oh, for a couple days, for sure, because we always give to the family. Our whole family fishes. So if we catch a big fish, we always have to go to our uncle's house, go to our aunt's, and drop some fillets off.
So what do you do if your dad wins a champion, if he catches a champion tuna? Do you mount it or do you eat it? What's the decision there?
We eat it. We don't mount fish unless, like, I don't know. We're not really big on that. We like eating it, so we eat it.
And the big call for anybody who's ever gone on a charter boat, fish on. That's the thing. And then everybody rushes to the pole. And so have you ever caught a sailfish or a marlin? Have you ever gone deep sea fishing?
Yes. The biggest fish I ever caught was a swordfish. It was 250-pound swordfish. And we were out 30 miles, probably 30 miles, I don't think how deep it was, maybe like 2,000 feet deep. And we were fishing on electric reel. And you just drop it. It's called day drop. And you drop it all the way down to probably like 600-800 feet. And the swordfish is pretty remarkable. They'll come all the way up from like 2,000 feet deep and get your bait and go all the way up in the air and go all the way back down. Like with their bellies, with all like the pressure down there, there's only a couple of fish that can do that. So it's pretty impressive.
How long did it take you to get that baby in?
We had it up to the boat in 30 minutes, but my uncle totally missed with the harpoon. So we had to wait another 2 hours to get it all the way back up. And then we got it the second time.
So the entire 2 hours after the misfire, everybody's kind of mumbling under their breath. Come on, man. What's going on? Can we trust you this time?
Yeah, it's a struggle. That's why we handed it to my other uncle so he can get it.
What was the most epic battle that you've ever seen? Maybe you were on the boat when somebody caught something big.
That's a good one. Probably one of this little dolphin we caught actually was because it was just jumping all over the place. It was me and my dad on our little flats boat like a couple years ago, maybe my senior year of high school, and it was just a really rainy, crappy day out, and all of a sudden this dolphin just hit the bait and just the rod reeling and screaming and just jumped out of the water and came back in. We were fighting it for a couple hours and we finally got in and we were so excited because we got fish again to eat. And it was the biggest dolphin I ever caught, and I was pumped.
And for those, we're not talking about flipper here. Those are porpoises. No. Dolphins are completely different fish.
Yes.
In fact, I was out on a charter one time and caught a couple of really nice red-tailed snapper. And a guy, I mean, it took him a while to get it in, but a green dolphin. Green. Have you ever seen one of those?
Yes, the Mahi Mahi. There's green. Some have like dots on them, and the females usually have that blue little dots in the back of them towards their tail.
So it's you probably have some great fish stories then.
Not too many as much as my brother. My brother has unbelievable fish stories because he's actually going to Cat Island to fish in the Bahamas. If you guys never heard of Cat Island, it's the farthest island in the Bahamas. It's super deserted, and the fish is unbelievable there because it's like no one lives there. So there's so much more fish. It hasn't been fished at all, and Cat Island's been like one of the biggest game fishing's been like in years.
So do you just go straight boat down there? Do you fly and then charter a boat? How's that work?
It depends. My brother's friend has a big boat, so they usually just take his boat and go down there. But usually if you don't have a boat, you got to fly down to Cat Island, and it's a sketchy plane ride, that's for sure.
All right. Tell us what it was like at St. Thomas Aquinas. Boy, they have a great history of winning championships in multiple sports at that high school.
It was a great experience. I actually went to St. Andrews my freshman year. Then once I got a call to go kick there, I transferred. And I remember my first day of practice, I was watching these guys. Like, they're all in, like, the NFL now. Like, Rashad Greene, Jake Rudock, LaMarcus Joyner. Like, watching these guys, Giovanni Bernard, James White. Like, unbelievable guys. And I'm watching this practice. I'm like, this is not a high school. This is a college. This is a Division I college. And one of my best friends actually now, Joey Bosa, he's playing really good for the Chargers right now. And I can never think, like, hanging out with them all in high school. Now he's in the NFL making millions, and never would have thought that would happen.
Well, at least if you ever go to a Chargers game, you got tickets.
Of course.
Give us some other names of guys who have swung through that school that we might recognize.
Michael Irvin, that's a big one. Chris Carter didn't go there, but he's always there coaching up. He was my wide receivers coach when I was there. I played a little bit of wide receiver there, but didn't really get on the field too much. So
those are two Hall of Famers, Michael Irvin and Chris Carter.
Yes, they are. And we have, I'm trying to think, a couple other ones are big. And I think a lot of them are still in the league, but I know they broke the record this year for the most high school to put in the NFL in ever. And they're still kicking butt with that because they just have produce because those coaches just know what they're doing down there.
So you were the punter in the 2012 Florida versus Georgia All-Star game. What was it like playing in a big all-star game like that? Because when you're talking about Florida and Georgia, those are two states that bring a lot of football talent.
I think that's the best part. My favorite thing is playing in big games because all the pressure's on you, and I love pressure. And that's one thing growing up I always loved doing. I was competing against my brother and all my friends. And playing in that Florida-Georgia game was the first time I ever punted in a game, and I had a great game. So I was really happy to be there and be a part of it.
For anybody that has not seen you punt, you're a left-footed punter. Are you left-handed in everything?
Actually, not really. It's kind of funny that people ask me that all the time. I write righty. I played when I used to play like tennis and baseball, I swung with my right hand, but I switched back to my left and I actually was better at it. So my mom thinks I was a lefty, but I just put all the things in my right hand. So I kind of ended up being a righty.
Is it different for somebody to, like, say, punt returner with the different rotation? Does that throw anybody off, or is it it's all the same?
Yes, it's a huge difference. That's why you see, like, in the NFL nowadays, they're starting to move to lefty punters, because you have to – every week, say you have a righty punter on your NFL team, you have to go bring in a guy that kicks lefty, because it's a totally different spin on the ball. Like, last week against Jacksonville State, like, there were some punts that he totally could have returned, because that returner is really good. But he told me, man, your spin's weird, and that's why he was fair catching it, because he doesn't know where the ball's going to go. Because when it comes down for righties, it usually comes this way, and for lefties, it comes that way. So if you're a returner, you're looking at the ball, you're so used to always going this way, going back to your left side's really hard for them.
So do you have aspirations? You want to see if you try your hand at maybe the next level once your college eligibility is over?
Yes, I definitely want to take a shot and see where that comes, and hopefully I make a team or practice squad and see what happens. That'd be awesome.
Well, you're leading the league in punting for a second straight year. Maybe we need to drug test some of the voters last year that voted you second team all conference, despite the fact that you led the league in punting. You're leading the league again this year. Three preseason All-American teams. That's got to be kind of cool when they tell you, hey, you just got voted an All-American.
Yeah, that was definitely a blessing for real. I thank God for that. And just all the hard work Coach Duke told me I've been doing, and just got to keep grinding every summer, and hopefully I don't really care what the OVC says about me. I just want to do my best, and I'm not worried about all the accolades. I just want to be the best I can be.
What do you think of the way that the punting game has evolved, and all of a sudden we got rugby guys, the guys that are kind of running out to the side, low kicks, hoping to get a big bounce? What do you think about rugby? Anyone ever tell you, hey, why don't you try rugby?
I've never really been a fan of rugby. I did it a little bit my freshman year because the other punter got hurt and I had to do it. But I know in college it's a huge thing because it gets your return guys down the field faster. And Coach Chuk always told me that was a huge thing. And I know next year they're probably going to be working on it a little bit with Jake Reynolds, a new punter coming in. But for me, I just never really been fond of it because I didn't like it. And I know I can do better and kick it further just doing traditional punting. So I'm happy Coach Chuk let me do that.
Now, did the fact that SEMO has produced All-American punters in the past, did that play any role in you coming here? I mean, what was the difference? Because we've had several All-American punters. This is Punter University, man. We've had some really good ones.
Not really. I just coming out, like, I wasn't really the highest recruited kicker coming out because I only really played a couple years in high school because there's a couple kickers in front of me at St. Thomas. But the opportunity came before Coach Chuk got here. The old coaches recruited me, and they said come in and kick. And I was really excited to get a full scholarship to come out here, and I couldn't say no to a full scholarship. I'm super blessed to get that.
That's fantastic. So tell me about the Corn Blue Kicking Challenge, because you were the champ 2 years in a row.
That was a great experience. It was this huge Corn Blue Kicking. He's a kicking coach back in Florida, and he's been running this program for I don't even know how long, many years. And it's a big challenge with all the best kickers in around the country, and they all come together and we compete. And that's one thing I always loved doing since high school was competing. So I always end up doing pretty good at those. And it's always hard with those guys because there's great kids. I know some kids went to Utah, some kids went to Nevada, and big time schools way bigger than I did. But at the end of the day, it's like whoever kicks the best wins.
So you went from kicker to punter. How big of a transition was that?
That was a big one for me. I got to admit, when Coach Martin and Coach Duke said, you got to punt, I was like, uh-oh. Because I never really punted. And I know my first day punting did not go too well with Coach Duke. So seeing all this transition for me was really good because it ended up for the best. Me being a lefty definitely helped. And just learning and working all summer, and Coach Duke let me go home and work this summer. And that was a huge thing for me to help me get going and have a great year.
So have you worked with punting? I mean, obviously you work with kicking coaches.
Yes.
When you work with punting coaches, you ever, you know, work with a coach and say, really, you haven't been punting your whole life? They're really amazed that you kind of took it up late in your career.
Yeah, some coaches say that, but some coaches see my athletic ability and say, hey, like, that's why you got it so quickly. And I really respect Coach Tony. He's been around for a while, and I work with Pat O'Donnell. He kicks for the Bears right now. Matt Darr, the Dolphins punter, and Ryan Quigley with the Arizona Cardinals. I work with them all summer, and that's one thing that really helped me out, because when you watch the pros do something and have a coach something, it's a little different because everyone wants to listen to the pros. When you listen to some old guy, it's a little different. When you listen to a pro, they're doing it. They're making money off it. So, you know, they know what they're doing.
So do you get feedback from these guys who are actually in the NFL?
Yes,
I think you got what it takes.
Yes, they've been telling me you just got to get your technique better. You got to shorten your steps and just do a couple things that a new punter would be trying to fix. And that's one thing I really like about all these pro guys, because they tell you straight up, you got it or you don't. And they said, if I get my stuff right, hopefully I got a chance, and we'll see what happens.
All right. When you are dropping the ball, I mean, how important is that? I mean, obviously, you know, some guys drop it further than other guys. And how long does it take to perfect that technique?
That's a lot. Like at home, just going on, I used to duct tape a line straight up and just do drops, 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 and drops. Because if you don't have a good drop, you might as well just quit. Because that's the most important thing about punting is your drop. Because if it turns a little bit to the left or right, you're going to mess it up. Or you can shank it out of bounds. You can hit it to the wrong side of the field. You can, it's a lot of bad can happen with a bad drop.
All right. 2 weeks ago, Austin Peay's in here. And their kicker is doing their punting in this particular game. And there are people on the Austin Peay sideline and in the student section sitting in the bleachers who had no idea they were going to get a football that day. And the punter is out there for Austin Peay, and he literally kicks it into the third row of the bleachers. Worst punt you've ever seen?
No, I probably had something worse than that. I can't. You never can hate on punters, because this is bad karma for you in the future. So I remember one.
You got to give him the business a little bit, though. Really? Third row, right?
Yeah, but I don't like talking bad about people. That's never been my thing, so I don't really talk about it. But it happens. Like, when you put the ball outside, it could happen like that. Like, it happens to everybody. So the pros do the same thing. I see plenty of pros shank the ball 10 yards out of bounds. So, and I just don't like talking bad about people, so that's on me.
Well, see, here was the debate we had. In baseball, you get a ball that it's hit to you, get to keep it. What's the rule in football? Can they keep the ball if you punt it into the stands?
Oh, that's not on me. That's on their coaches and Coach Hankinson on our side. If he needs the ball, he goes and gets it.
All right. As you guys get ready for UT Martin coming up, what's the thought process here going in? And, you know, and I know you got to get going to class here. So real quickly, the kicking game, it's got to be cool to play for a coach who puts so much emphasis on the kicking game.
Yes, it's a really great thing, because one, it actually brings the best out of us, especially me and Ryan McCrum, because we've been working, like my freshman year, they didn't really care about kicking with these old coaches. But when Coach Tuke came here, he knew special teams was a big part of the program. And for us, that's the biggest thing for us, because we get to come out every day and we have to perform practice. If we don't, we won't play. And especially this week, UT Martin's going to be a big one, because they're a good team. So if I can flip the field, if I can put the ball on the one-yard line, I'll do my best to help the team out and win.
All right. We know you got to get run into a class. Are you on Twitter? Can we get you a couple of followers?
Yes. My Twitter account is anightkick@AOL.com. So follow me, please.
All right. There it is. Alex, pleasure to have you, and appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Alex Knight, Red Hawks All-American punter, joining us here. He's got to run. He's got to get to class. We will talk it over with Coach Tuke when we come back. It's the Red Hawks Coaches Show at Wings Etc. on SEMO ESPN.